Archives of Prasar Bharati presents The Timeless Treasure, The Vision and Philosophy of Gandhi.
I have nothing new to teach the world. Truth and nonviolence are as old as the hills.
Gandhiji, in his autobiography, wrote that a perfect vision of truth can only follow a complete realization of ahimsa.
In the midst of untruth, truth persists. In the midst of darkness, light persists. Hence I gather that God is life, truth, light. He is love.
Ahimsa is the farthest limit of humility.
Even in 1942, when he had called it the last struggle and given the slogan, do or die, he had ensured that the movement remained peaceful and non-violent.
One man, Englishman, his name is Mr. Sank. He was the manager of Orangtee Estate. He was anti-Congress, anti-Gandhi, anti-Indian, anti-everything.
Pushplata Das, veteran freedom fighter and a close associate of Mahatma Gandhi.
He wanted to see what is Gandhiji's non-violent movement. So when peacefully procession was coming, peaceful procession, peacefully they came and stand. There is a change in his face. Then, one after another, when they're facing bullets with a smile in their face, then it seems, suddenly, in excitement, he said, now I understand what is Gandhiji's non-violence. One can't kill like this. One can kill when one runs away. There is a pleasure in killing in that way. But one can't kill like this when they face death with a smile in their face.
Gandhiji belongs to that race of prophets who have the courage of heart, the courtesy of spirit, and the laughter of the unafraid.
Talking about the salt satyagraha, Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay wrote,
"The launching of the satyagraha was fixed for the 6th of April, observed annually in the memory of the agonizing tragedy at Jallianwala Bagh in 1919. Although India has a long, illustrious tradition of women warriors, this was their first appearance in any modern militant political campaign. And I could hardly suppress my excitement at the enormity of the occasion. And even as I lit my little fire to boil the salt water, I saw thousands of fires of flame dancing in the wind. The copper pans sizzled in laughter while their bosoms traced the white grains of salt as the heat lapped up the last drop of water. The police found it hard to break through the circle, so deep was it. They charged with their batons. The human wall was still unyielding. In the meantime, police on horseback charged at the general crowd, but they sat silent and immovable. I could hear the dull thud as the blows fell, faint moans as the wounded struck the ground. Still, not a cry, not an angry snarl. Men and women, young and old, were all facing the attack with unbelievable composure.
Generations to come, it may be, wrote Einstein of Gandhi in July 1944, will scarcely believe that such a one as this, ever in flesh and blood, walked upon the earth.
Wiley M. Foster believed that he was likely to be considered the greatest man of our century. Arnold Toynbee was convinced of it.
Dr. J.H. Holmes described him as the greatest Indian since Gautam the Buddha, and the greatest man since Jesus Christ. Nehru had once described him as a magician. Winston Churchill called him the naked fakir.
Former Prime Minister Morarji Desai will soon be 100 years old, a staunch Gandhian. In a special recording with us, he said,
"He was a unique person, and I have not found anybody like him in the world. He believed in truth, non-violence, and service of all people.
And in the hearts of his people, he is the Mahatma, the father of the nation. Endearingly, Bapu."
We remember today the liberator of our country, the father of our nation, Mahatma Gandhi.
Dr. B.N. Pandey, Vice Chairman of Gandhi Darshan and Smriti, and an old associate of Gandhiji.
Gandhiji, as is well known, wanted to live for 125 years. Unfortunately, that did not happen, or we Indians did not allow it to come true. So now today, when we are celebrating his 125th birth anniversary, I think it is our duty to see that Gandhiji is made alive.
Dr. Usha Mehta, a well-known freedom fighter and a devoted follower of the Mahatma.
That the present generation is made to feel that Gandhi still lives. Physically, he may not be with us, but so far as his teachings are concerned, so far as his message is concerned, message which is that we must try to establish a moral man in a moral society. So that is not only relevant today, but I think it will be relevant for all time to come, and especially for all those who want to lead a better and a nobler life, as also those who want to build a braver and a newer world.
We want to remind our countrymen that India had the good fortune to produce a unique figure.
Sadiq Ali, a long-time associate of Gandhiji and the chairman of Gandhi Smarak Nidhi.
He brought us not only freedom by what we call peaceful and truthful means through non-violent techniques, but he also presented to us his vision of a free India.
I think we have reached a point where it is almost painful when we talk about Gandhiji and today's India.
Raj Mohan Gandhi, writer, thinker, and a grandson of the Mahatma.
He stood for peace, but we take great pride in exporting arms. He stood for the rejection of high and low, but in some ways we have a very high and low, almost a feudal type society.
Bahar hum chale jate hain, ahimsa ki baat karte hain, gandhivad ki baat karte hain, apne aap ko Mahatma Gandhi ka uttardayi ya uttaradhikari kehte hain, to sunne walon ko yakeen nahi hota.
Prime Minister Narasimha Rao.
Humse wo vaad nahi karte, behas nahi karte, lekin unke man mein lagta hoga ki ye keval Gandhi ka naam lene wale hain, Gandhi ke raaste par ye chalna nahi chahte. Aaj ye sara kalank hame dhona hai is desh se, iske siwa aur koi gatyantar nahi hai.
Gandhiji had worked for a non-violent and harmonious society in which people of different communities and religions would live in peace and dignity.
He argued for spiritual brotherhood, the great verse which has now come to be used as Ram Dhoom. Is taken from Guru Gobind Singh's hymns, where it starts, Mandira Masjid Tere Dham, Ishwara Allah Tere Naam.
Dr. Sarvapalli Radhakrishnan, former President of India, spoke on the occasion of Gandhi Jayanti at Tilak Bhavan, Hyderabad, in 1958.
He has put it there that Mandir and Masjid is the residence of God, and Ishwar and Allah are the names which we give to God. He believed in religion. Religion was the inspiration of his life. If today we utter great things and practice low, it is due to this split in our own mind. We profess to be practicing his ideals, but our practices do not conform to his ideals. And if a kind of oneness, homogeneity, integration is to be brought about in the human individual, it can only be by means of this religious discipline.
Whether we are Hindus or Muslims or Christians or Sikhs, we are all equal citizens, and we want to solve problems facing the entire nation, facing people of all communities.
Gandhiji was a highly religious person. He laid the greatest stress on his spiritual and religious values, but he was clear in his mind that there was no place for religion in the political life of a nation.
Therefore, when he said religion must be kept out of politics, he didn't mean that moral values should be kept out. Moral values are highly important. They must guide the life of an individual and the life of the nation.
He asks us to practice meditation, to fast and pray on occasions, to control our appetites and bring about a harmony in our own nature, where the head and the heart don't fight with one another.
Dr. Sarvapalli Radhakrishnan.
In the Vishnu Puran, there is a verse which says, Sarva Bhutatmake Tata Jagannathe Jagannamaye Paramatmani Govinde Mitra Amitra Katha Kutaha. If you feel that you are the offspring of the one divine, if you are hewn from the same rock, that you spring from the same source, you will never look upon your neighbor as Amitra. Sarva Bhutatmake Tata Jagannathe Jagannamaye Paramatmani Govinde Mitra Amitra Katha Kutaha. That is what Gandhi asked us to practice. He was the great reconciler between the rich and the poor, reconciler between members of different communities, reconciler who wanted to bring about a unity of the world.
Gandhi had said, "My mission is to teach by example and precept, under severe restraint, the use of the matchless weapon of satyagraha, which is a direct corollary of non-violence and truth. I am anxious, indeed I am impatient, to demonstrate that there is no remedy for the many ills of life save that of non-violence."
In a rare letter dated October the 22nd, 1932, Romain Rolland wrote to Gandhiji,
"My dearly beloved and revered friend, the whole of humanity has an interest in the results of the great experiment which you are directing. We can but wait for them and believe, as the great experiment unfolds itself according to the strict laws of the truth, like science. But on these results depend the destiny of the world and the shape of future action in it. And only the success of the satyagraha experiment can save humanity from the torrents of violence hanging over it."
Yours, Romain Rolland, Villa Olga, Switzerland.
Gandhi was thinking far ahead of his times. He was not thinking merely of the freedom of the country as freedom from British rule.
N. Krishnaswamy, noted Gandhian and former secretary Gandhi Smarak Nidhi and Gandhi Peace Foundation.
He wanted a radical restructuring of our society in tune with the ethos, with our own traditions, with our own heritage, a system that would replace the British system, which had distorted our values for its own purposes. He wanted a society where every individual would have the minimum needs of his life met.
He encouraged khadi and rural crafts to create work and employment for the vast majority of our villagers.
Khadi and Village Industries Commission is a very important instrument for ushering in the concept of Gandhi.
Naval Kishore Sharma, Chairman Khadi and Village Industries Commission.
Gandhiji believed in self-sufficiency of the villages. Self-sufficiency of the villages, which he termed as Gram Swaraj.
Gandhiji was opposed to the use of machinery which enslaved man, but not to machinery which helped man to find his basic needs.
Khadi and Village Industries is going to launch a program in 125 blocks of this country and has an ambitious plan of providing employment to 1,000 people at least in these 125 blocks. Here too, we have decided that the selection of the 125 blocks should be of those blocks which consists of the poorest of the poor of this country.
About Gandhiji, Rabindranath Tagore had written,
"He, Gandhi, stopped at the thresholds of the huts of the thousands of the dispossessed, dressed like one of their own. Who else has felt, like him, that all Indians are his own flesh and blood? In direct contact with the truth, the crushed forces of the soul rise again. When love came to the door of India, that door was opened wide. At Gandhi's call, India blossomed forth to new greatness, just as once before in earlier times, when the Buddha proclaimed the truth of fellow feeling and compassion among all living creatures."
He gave us a philosophy of not merely mass production, but production by masses.
C. Subramaniam, a strict Gandhian, former union minister and former governor of Maharashtra.
So that the production process would give the advantage to the entire people for earning a wage so that they may live with self-respect.
Gandhiji was convinced that only through the self-sufficiency of its villages could India survive.
He saw people in this country living almost in villages. He wanted that Gram Raj should continue.
Justice Krishna Swami Reddia, former Chief Justice of the Madras High Court.
The Gram Raj, every villager living in the village has been doing his own work. And Gandhiji's theory was that the village life is the best life. That's the life you see where you can have peaceful life because your wants are restricted there.
He presented to India his vision of a new social and economic order in a free and independent India.
Gandhiji was always thinking of how to make democracy more meaningful, how to make it possible to reach the fruits of democracy to all classes of people, and also how to make the country free of strife and confrontation.
Gandhiji laid special stress on self-sufficiency in the basic necessities of life. He also laid special stress on what we called Panchayati Raj, local self-government in the highest measure possible.
Sadiq Ali.
After all, democracy is not meant for the few. It is meant for all. And everyone, this democratic process is at the moment confined only to elections, to state assemblies and parliament. This is obviously not enough. Therefore, Panchayati Raj has to be activized.
Gandhiji was against conspicuous consumption and over-industrialization.
He said, if you over-industrialize, then a time would come
the world will have to face the problem of an environment.
Dr. B. N. Pandey.
Now, many cities of the world, in USA and in Europe, and even a city like Delhi has been declared as most polluted cities of the world.
Gandhiji, he said one very important and vital thing. Why is there so much starvation in the country or in the world? Why there are great inequalities?
Sadiq Ali.
He had said, there's enough for everybody's need, but there's not enough for everybody's greed.
Gandhiji had unflinching faith in the human spirit and spiritual values. It is in this context that Dr. Francis Nielsen said of Gandhiji, a Diogenes in action, a Saint Francis in humility, a Socrates in wisdom, he reveals to the world the utter futility of the use of force.
The world has witnessed the tragic destruction of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and then began the race of nuclear weapons. Even the scientists who were responsible for making nuclear weapons, they began to say, if this race is not stopped, and if the nuclear weapons are not destroyed, then the world will have to face the catastrophe.
Dr. B. N. Pandey.
What is happening in the intellectual and academic circle of USA? In scores of universities, now the scholars are busy in the researches of Gandhian principles. So in this way, world is being drawn towards Gandhi unknowingly, unconsciously, because they are fed up with violence.
जब हम चेकोस्लोवाकिया की ओर नजर डालते हैं, जब दक्षिण अफ्रीका में अमेरिका का निग्रो हलचल में अहिंसा का चमत्कार देखते हैं,
अन्नपूर्णा मोहराना, a veteran Gandhian freedom fighter,
जर्मनी के जैसे राष्ट्र भी ऐलान कर रहे हैं कि आज के परमाणु युग में मानव समाज की रक्षा के लिए महात्मा गांधी का अहिंसक तरीका ही एकमेव रक्षा करता है, तब हमारे दिल में अहिंसा के प्रति श्रद्धा बढ़ती जाती है और हमारे कान में गूंजती रहती है उपनिषद की वह वाणी जी सत्यमेव जयते.
The world is interested in Gandhi a little more objectively and more truthfully, I think, than many in India are.
Raj Mohan Gandhi.
The spirit of Gandhi is much stronger today than some people believe.
Martin Luther King Jr.
Mahatma Gandhi embodied in his life certain universal principles that are inherent in the moral structure of the universe. And these principles are as inescapable as the law of gravitation. And if this age is to survive, it must follow the way of love and nonviolence that he so nobly illustrated in his life. And Mahatma Gandhi may well be God's appeal to this generation. No nation can win a war. Today we no longer have a choice between violence and nonviolence. It is either nonviolence or non-existence.
Even after the cessation of Cold War, the suspicion in each other's mind and in the statesmen of different nations, it has not gone, it has not disappeared. So, as is rightly said, violence is bound to breed counter-violence, and therefore it is not a permanent solution. The permanent solution lies only in developing a sense of compassion, in developing a sense of unity and solidarity amongst all nations of the world, among all peoples of the world.
Dr. Usha Mehta.
This his universal outlook or his craze for world peace and brotherhood also, I think, is a very great contribution of his to world politics, to international relations. And therefore it is that we have seen that in many parts of the country, whether it is in the South African struggle or in a country like France or Italy, where you have Lanza Davasto, Danilo Dolci and others, as also in other countries where peace movement is gaining ground every day, all these go to prove that Gandhi's principles are not only as relevant as they were, but perhaps more relevant in view of the growing terrorism in the world or growing reliance on violence and violent methods.
The intellectual class, the thinking class in the West and other countries have not only heard about Gandhiji, they have studied him. And they find that Gandhiji holds the key to the solution of many problems facing humanity.
My faith is that within 10 years you'll see a change. Change for better.
Morarji Desai.
What is happening now will not happen. People will not quarrel among themselves. They live happily and doing service.
In a world of violence, he dared to preach the doctrine of non-violence. Gandhiji had made it his life's mission to bring home to his fellow men all over the world the conviction that there is no salvation for them, whether as individuals, communities, or nations, unless they tread the path of non-violence and truth. Mahatma Gandhi delivered us from bondage to freedom, from darkness to light, and he brought us back our heritage.
Gandhiji gave us our traditional values of truth, non-violence, compassion, of tolerance, of humanity as one without any barriers of caste or religion or region or nation.
Rajiv Gandhi, October the 2nd, 1988.
Today, we should think of the values that he inculcated in us, the values that he introduced in our freedom struggle, the values that helped us vanquish one of the greatest empires that ever stood. It is only with his vision that we can really build a new society in the world today.
Gandhiji's nobility of character, his commitment to non-violence and peace, had evoked reverence from all.
He created a sense of oneness, the spiritual unity of the world, the affirmation of a humanism that transcends boundaries. Gandhiji belongs to all, not to India alone.